Hello and welcome to the session on Remedial Guidance. In every classroom, there are students who do not respond to developmental guidance. Some students do not even respond to the teacher's effort to instill habits directed towards growth, development, and mental hygiene. The reasons behind such negative response and attitudes can vary from early childhood experiences to previous school experiences. Such experiences can have a blighting effect upon the overall personality of the child and externally manifested behavior. To relieve their feelings, they usually engage in behavior that provides some immediate attention and gratifies their psychological needs. But such behaviors can affect the overall functioning of the classroom and can end up as a self-defeating exercise for the child who engages in it. An effective way to deal with such situations is providing guidance to cope with present problems in a constructive way. Remedial guidance is one such attempt in which the child is introduced to positive models of responding to present environmental challenges. The first step in remedial guidance is identifying the need that prompts a particular behavior in a child. If the teacher can recognize such needs, he or she can start the process of remedial guidance through trying to change both the environment and providing some active guidance for coping with such environmental challenges. This process can genuinely affect the child's social and emotional adjustment. A common experience of remedial guidance workers is that once the child gets a better understanding of the problem, the child himself or herself would take some active steps towards resolving the problem or crisis. With a successful resolution of crisis, the child will do better at school and adjust well with peer group and family, and will respond more positively to instruction. Remedial guidance becomes crucial in situations involving problems that go beyond simple developmental problems. To put it simply, developmental problems are the obstacles associated with the process of growing up. Though it appears as a problem to the growing child, most of them are developmental tasks identified with each stage of development. The successful resolution of each one of these would result in increased maturity. These problems represent temporary concerns than more serious fault lines. They have positive value as they provide an opportunity to grow, and in the long run, it will be a self-strengthening exercise. They can be addressed and alleviated by parents and teachers. It is important to distinguish common developmental problems from the serious ones to understand the importance of remedial guidance. A teacher is the best person to identify this through asking questions such as, "Is this child's behavior common to children at his stage of development? Or does he act his age? Or is he immature on the one hand or precocious on the other?" Remedial guidance is a teamwork where numbers of experts are involved in the identification, assessment, and care of the identified problem. The following sections deals with the nature and kinds of problems that generally requires remedial guidance. The nature of problems. Both immaturity and precociousness can be considered as broad areas of problems. The immature child most often becomes retarded and most often fails in schoolwork. This failure in turn gives rise to feelings of inferiority and inadequacy and general lack of self-confidence. Precociousness can also generate problems unless it is recognized and proper provisions are made. The precocious child usually becomes bored, apathetic, or lazy and most often work below his or her capacity. Understanding the problem is the most significant aspect of remedial guidance. To gain understanding of why a child or adolescent behaves as he does needs careful attention to the causes and results of a particular behavior. Usually, identification of a problem happens when the teacher asks certain questions to a manifested behavior. The major questions are as follows. What are the basic values or guiding principles that direct a child's behavior? What are the major problems the child is trying to solve? What does the child hope to accomplish? What are his goals? Who are the players who have significant influence upon the child? What satisfaction the child is getting from the present pattern of behavior? In what direction the child is moving? Such an inquiry helps to draw many inferences regarding the present behavior. It would also help understand the multiple causal factors that lead to a particular behavior. It can also show the complex environmental interactions and influences on behavior. Such a detailed inquiry can help prevent falling into hasty generalizations and unsubstantiated conclusions. If the teacher checks out all possible background information, this can also contribute to multiple ways of dealing the problem. For instance, if a particular behavioral problem is coming not from the child, but from one of the parents of the child would benefit from correcting the behavior of parents. Sometimes, all other methods can fail if proper attention is not paid on the familial environment. Physical disability is a similar area that remains overlooked in assessment of the problem. For instance, a minor defect in vision or hearing can contribute to reading disability. Similarly, there can be problems that generate first order and second order impairment. Take the case of an orthopedic handicap. It prevents a boy from participating in sports and can cause social withdrawal. This is the first and immediate layer of the problem. But at the secondary level, there is emotional maladjustment that's coming out of restricted mobility and lack of social life. Usually, such secondary problems are much more difficult in dealing with and needs proper psychological assessment of the problem to ensure prognosis. One of the major problems that require remedial guidance is what lay people call disruptive behavior and psychologists refer to as attention deficit hyperactive disorder or ADHD. Very short span of attention and destructive tendencies are the major symptoms of this disorder. This behavior is both self-destructive and can affect the effective management of the classroom situation. Another situation involves serious learning disability such as dyslexia or dyscalculia. Such students are prone to underachievement and this leads to a host of other issues such as lack of motivation, expressed dislike of school going, etc. Other than this problem, there are some other problems which also demand serious attention. The extreme tendency to withdraw, excessive daydreaming, general apathy, habitual unhappiness, marked indifference to other people's feelings, and over-moral behavior, etc., can be found in classrooms. All these situations demand psychological care to understand the deep-seated reasons behind such behaviors. Problem-specific guidance. The major problems that need remediation fall into two broad categories. Guidance for underachievers and guidance for discipline problems. Underachievement happens due to multiple reasons and it can vary from physiological reasons to psychological reasons. Retardation exists at many levels such as reading, writing, comprehending, etc. The most common among them is retardation at reading. On every grade and on every class there are retarded readers. Physiological reasons such as visual or hearing impairment can result in underachievement. there are innumerable psychological reasons that can contribute to academic underachievement. They range from negative childhood experiences such as rejection from parents, familial conflicts, emotional conflicts, etc., to indifference from teachers and peer group. Apathetic learning conditions and poor instruction too contribute to not so desirable results. Absence of cultural stimulation and negative self-image too can contribute to this situation. All underachievers benefit immensely from early detection and proper usage of referral services. The class teacher being the person who is close contact with the students in a daily basis is the most active agent who can find out underachievers in an early stage. They should recognize that their pupils have wide individual differences in reading and language abilities, home backgrounds, motivation, and attitude towards the school and towards themselves and educational and vocational goals. They should try to discover the assets of each learning profile. Students are rarely low in all aspects of achievement. Identifying the strongholds of an individual can help in the remediation process. The teacher should concentrate on the weak links or points of vulnerability that creates difficulty in the achievement. Once such a realization comes to the teacher, he or she should provide extra instructional material and should help the student to engage with that material. The problem with gifted underachievers is that they might find the academic activity boring and monotonous as it is designed to cater the needs of the average student. Such a gifted child might develop negative study habits and will become an underachiever. The teacher can help avoiding this through letting the bright ones work as group part of the time of academic activities. Disciplinary problems are quite common among all schools, though education tries to inculcate an internal feeling of discipline within the students. Some disciplinary problems, such as ADHD, requires proper care and attention to keep it under control and for the smooth functioning of the classroom. Some believe that disciplinary problems are the outcome of circumstances beyond the immediate control of the individual. So it's important to keep the school permeated with an atmosphere that prevents disciplinary problems and facilitates dealing with the disciplinary problems through guidance. By gradually relinquishing control, as the students become able to assume responsibility, the teacher helps them to learn self-discipline. To deal with chronic misbehavior, teamwork is necessary. A group of teachers and specialists can come together in such situations and discuss the situation and pool their knowledge of the student. Case conferences and role plays are helpful in such situation. A typical role-playing session is as follows. For example, imagine a classroom situation where a student keeps on asking some doubts so that teacher has to repeat the same lesson repeatedly. The boy's behavior is a subtle expression of aggression, or it is passive aggression. In a typical role-playing session, the teacher who plays the role of teacher would show others how would deal with the situation. The session can be analyzed later to know the effectiveness of teachers' responses. In such a situation, a group can observe that the teacher was inclined to argue with students. Finally, the group can make suggestions about handling the situation. Further analysis can be done in which teachers' responses can be taken as a response to a situation where his or her authority has been challenged. Such an analysis is helpful to understand how one could explore one's own feelings and can arrive at a better picture of how their emotions involved in disciplining without their own realizations. The adjectives used can be studied carefully to understand the further dynamics of the situation. The majority of the disciplinary problems yield to the procedures just described, but some, of course, do not. The behavior is too deep-seated, too long established as a habit, too ingrained in the whole personality pattern to respond to educational methods. The teacher must recognize these pupils for what they are and not become discouraged when they do not respond to kindness, warmth, and careful instruction. The crux of remedial guidance lies in the ability of the personnel involved in the process to continue the process till the desired effect is elicited in the behavior. Since remedial guidance is always directed towards behavior modification, and behavior modification being one of the most difficult goals to achieve, endurance is one quality that defines the outcome. Cognitive Behavior Therapy, CBT. The most effective techniques used these days for behavior modification is Cognitive Behavior Therapy, CBT. The focus is on the ways in which a person's thoughts, emotions, attitude, affect, and behavior are related. CBT assumes that some people develop negative and distorted beliefs about themselves and about the world, and this can interfere seriously with their functioning. They are called dysfunctional belief system that operates at the level of cognition. CBT tries to understand and uproot these dysfunctional thoughts through teaching individuals to hold back dysfunctional beliefs through counteracting them. Let's take the case of ADHD to understand how CBT functions. ADHD is characterized by difficulty with organization, prioritizing, and follow-through. Some of them have chronic attention difficulties and they tend to ramble. They find it difficult to remain on topic and often forget what they have committed to do. Cognitive behavioral therapy uses a number of techniques which exclusively focus on these difficulties. CBT starts with finding out the tasks the child finds most difficult in achieving and develops certain clear-cut goals around it. These goals are further divided into sub-goals, where the child won't find it overwhelming. The therapist would articulate these goals clearly for the child so that he or she won't end up rambling and jumping from one topic to another. The child is encouraged to do some self-evaluation in relation to the completion of the tasks in which the child can come up with interesting insights about one's own potentials and limitations. This is accompanied with rigorous follow-ups from the counselor in which the child can bring up specific issues in achieving the goal. These sessions help to evaluate the progress and problems in achieving a particular goal within a stipulated time. The counselor can help through providing a consistent routine to the days and structure to the environment. It also creates clear boundaries and expectations. Another important method is employment of graphic and visual methods for record keeping. The child is actively encouraged to keep such records so that he or she can clearly see the points where they are prone to fail. Devising an appropriate reward system along with these techniques can help improve the effectiveness of these techniques. Another important feature of CBT is equipping the child to fight with negative feelings. The child might have developed over the years certain ways of engaging with the environment. For instance, a stressful situation immediately generates fear of failure in many. This can be overwhelming feeling, and the child might engage in destructive behaviors to overcome the situation. In such situations, CBT helps come out of such cyclical thinking patterns that get generated automatically. Techniques of remedial guidance. This section deals with the general techniques used by in classroom to deal with a situation that requires remedial guidance. These are helpful in dealing with common behavioral problems. 1. Diverting attention. This technique works well with toddlers as it is easy to distract them and their span of attention is very limited. An activity which you disapprove can be substituted with another more desirable activity. Since the child will not be in a position to engage in a dialogue through which an understanding of the situation can be developed, the technique of diverting attention is more effective. 2. Calming time. Calming time helps to separate children who are fighting, who are overexcited, and who are calm. This comes as a sudden end to the fight in which the teacher can explain the fighting parties that they have to sit some time calmly. This helps the children to come out of the emotional loads of fighting and also give strong warning that the teacher won't allow that behavior and it is not desirable. 3. Ignoring misbehavior. Students generally engage with misbehavior to attract attention. So, ignoring that behavior becomes an effective technique that helps not to reinforce it. This can be compensated with paying adequate attention when they behave well. 4. Redirect behavior. This is a variation of the technique diverting attention mentioned earlier. Here again, an unwanted behavior is exchanged with a more positive one. 5. Consequences. This method involves letting the children eat the fruit of their action. Of course, this technique is context specific and should be varied with the ethical and legal concerns. It should never overlook the personal safety of the child. Let me summarize the main ideas we have discussed so far. Remedial guidance tries to address the specific problems faced by the child in school environment. It tries to help the child come out of an already happened maladjustment or breakdown. In remedial guidance, the child is introduced to positive models of responding to present environmental challenges. The first step in remedial guidance is identifying the need that prompts a particular behavior in a child. If the teacher can recognize such needs, he or she can start the process of remedial guidance through trying to change both the environment and providing some active guidance for coping with such environmental challenges. This process can genuinely affect the child's social and emotional adjustment. A common experience of remedial guidance workers is that once a child gets a better understanding of the problem, the child himself or herself would take some active steps towards resolving the problem or crisis. With the successful resolution of crisis, the child will do better at school and adjust well with peer group and family and will respond more positively to instruction. It uses many specific psychological and behavioral modification techniques such as cognitive behavioral therapy in the process of guidance. Hope that you may attempt these questions given here. What is remedial guidance? What is the role of teacher in remedial guidance? What are major problems which require remedial guidance? What are the situations in which remedial guidance is recommended? What is the major behavior modification techniques used in remedial guidance? What is meant by psychological breakdown? Now, you can refer these books for further understanding. Guidance in Today's School, Mortensen, G. Donald and Schmuller, Allen, 1962, published by John Wiley and Sons, New York. Guidance in Classroom, Strang, Ruth and Morris, Glynn, 1964, published by Collier and Macmillan Limited, London. Thank you for watching this program. We can meet again with another topic soon. Take care.